the Lord. All right, Romans chapter 14, and I'm going to begin reading at verse 1. We're going to read a little bit lengthier portion of Scripture than we typically do, but right on the heels of Easter, I know you're spiritually strong enough to handle it. Amen? So starting at verse 1, the Apostle Paul says, "As for the one who is weak in faith, welcome him, but not to quarrel over opinions. One person believes he may eat anything, while the weak person eats only vegetables. Let not the one who eats despise the one who abstains, and let not the one who abstains pass judgment on the one who eats, for God has welcomed him. Who are you to pass judgment on the servant of another? It is before his own master that he stands or falls, and he will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One person esteems one day as better than another, while another esteems all days alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. The one who observes the day observes it in honor of the Lord. The one who eats, eats in honor of the Lord, since he gives thanks to God. While the one who abstains, abstains in honor of the Lord and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother? Or you, why do you despise your brother? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, 'As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God.' So then, each of us will give an account of himself to God. Therefore, let us not pass judgment on one another any longer, but rather decide never to put a stumbling block or a hindrance in the way of a brother. I know, and am persuaded in the Lord Jesus, that nothing is unclean in itself, but it is unclean for anyone who thinks it unclean. For if your brother is grieved by what you eat, you are no longer walking in love. By what you eat, do not destroy the one for whom Christ died. So do not let what you regard as good be spoken of as evil. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Whoever thus serves Christ is acceptable to God and approved by men. So then let us pursue what makes for peace and for mutual upbuilding. Do not, for the sake of food, destroy the work of God. Everything is indeed clean, but it is wrong for anyone to make another stumble by what he eats. It is good not to eat meat or drink wine or do anything that causes your brother to stumble. The faith that you have, keep between yourself and God. Blessed is the one who has no reason to pass judgment on himself for what he approves. But whoever has doubts is condemned if he eats, because the eating is not from faith. For whatever does not proceed from faith is sin." And I'll just go a few verses into 15. "We who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Let each of us please his neighbor for his good, to build him up. For Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, 'The reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me.' For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore," Paul says, "welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you, for the glory of God." Today we're going to talk about this topic, how to develop a welcoming spirit. How to develop a welcoming spirit. Would you pray with me? Let's invite the Holy Spirit to help us as we look into God's word today. Father, we come to you now in Jesus' beautiful name. We thank you for the gift of your holy word. Jesus said that the word of God is like seed. So, Father, we ask you that you would touch our hearts in these next minutes. Lord, would you let our hearts be good soil now, soil that can receive and hold on to and bear fruit from the seed of the word of God. Lord Jesus, you said the words you speak to us, they are spirit and they are life. So send your spirit now, we pray, and minister life to us out of the word. If you agree with that, would you say amen and amen? Well, for a few weeks, we've been talking about having a transformed Christian mind. We've seen that if we want to discover God's will and do it, we need to experience a radical change in how we think. In Romans 12, verse 2, Paul says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, so that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect." In order to do the will of God, we need to think differently than unbelievers do. Our values must be kingdom values and not the values of this world. We began this series saying that if our heart is transformed by Christ, that will also lead to a mind transformed by Christ. And we can continue to renew our minds by feeding on the Word of God. It will help us to think Christianly and to understand things from God's perspective. How many of you know that God said if you meditate in His Word day and night, you'll prosper, you'll have good success? So we've been sharing what the Bible teaches us about a number of topics such as God and creation and how we should love each other as brothers. And a few weeks back, just before Easter, just before we were sharing messages of the Easter season, Pastor Glenn shared with us about how we can also love our enemies. As we jump back into our Transform series this morning, we want to talk about a different aspect of Christian love, and it's how we can develop a welcoming spirit towards our fellow believers, especially those who differ from us. It's an important question, and it's one that believers will face time and again. How should we treat Christians who disagree with us about matters of conscience? Maybe you've been in church long enough to hear some teaching and preaching about resolving conflicts in a godly manner. And that's certainly a valuable lesson, but we can also use some instruction from the Lord on how to avoid those disputes in the first place. How to be more understanding of people who don't see things the way we do. You know, it's only a matter of time until we run into somebody who doesn't believe the way that we do about some element of our Christian faith. You may even meet somebody who looks down his nose at you a little bit because you don't see things his way or you don't do it his way. This was the situation that Paul was addressing in Romans 14. Paul had learned that two groups of Christians were harming each other. They were squabbling and they were judging each other over matters of conscience. Paul calls one of these groups the weak. Bible scholars tell us that the weak here were Jewish believers in Jesus. The gospel gave them the liberty to eat all kinds of different foods, but being raised in Judaism, many of them felt that they could not eat the meat that was available in Rome. For the most part, that meat wasn't prepared in accordance with the kosher laws they had grown up with. Because of their background, they also felt that they needed to keep certain feast days. They did have faith in the gospel, but Paul would say that their faith was weak. There were also other believers, Paul says, most likely Gentiles, whom he calls the strong. And because they didn't have a Jewish background, it was easier for them to see that Christ had fulfilled the law of Moses, everything that had to do with dates and diets and so on. They had never been exposed to the law's demands, and so it wasn't hard for them to just eat whatever they wanted or to ignore certain feast days. Paul would say that these people had a stronger faith in the gospel. They had a better grasp of our freedom in Christ, like we were singing about at the start of the service. Paul says in verse 14 that the strong believers were actually correct. In Christ Jesus, we do have liberty to eat things that were forbidden under Moses' law. Nor must we keep the feast of Israel, though we can if we want to. Those things will not bring us into a relationship with God. Paul says, "I know and I'm persuaded in the Lord Jesus that nothing is unclean in and of itself." How many of you know Paul's been teaching all the way through Romans that keeping laws is not the way to become righteous in God's sight? In Romans, Paul consistently says that we are saved through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. When we trust in Jesus and his sacrifice, God will credit righteousness to my account. Righteousness comes to us as a gift and not as a reward. There is no one who can ever earn a place in God's heaven. We gain heaven through the unmerited kindness of Christ. Should have been more than four amens on that. Praise God. You got to help. You know it's lonely up here in the pulpit. You got to help me out. And that is the glorious, albeit offensive, message of the gospel. And it applies to all mankind, both Jew and Gentile. The Roman church faced problems of conscience, problems that can still make trouble for believers today. You may have a strong faith in what Christ allows you to do. You may hold and you may teach correct doctrines. You may have liberty in Christ. And yet for all that, you might still be damaging the faith of those who are newer and weaker than yourself. It falls to you as a stronger believer to be patient and help those who are weak to better understand what Jesus has done for us. Paul says that those of us who are strong need to bear with the weak. It's also true, Paul says, that the weaker believers might judge people who do the things that they themselves might not do. And by becoming judgmental, the weaker believers damage their own faith. The Christians in Rome were committing both of these errors. The Gentiles were telling the Jews, you shouldn't be practicing Jewish things. And the Jews were telling the Gentiles, you should be practicing Jewish things. But church, I want you to see with me here that Paul is not merely addressing a first century debate about foods and holidays. He is speaking to us also, and he's asking us to think Christianly about matters of conscience. The Holy Spirit is telling us to check our hearts and to make sure that we are properly loving all of our brothers and sisters and helping them to grow. So in Romans 14 and 15, I find Paul giving us four helpful keys that will help us to get along in the family of God. Four keys that will help us to develop a welcoming spirit. So let's look together at four keys to developing a welcoming spirit. The first one is this: open your arms to your brothers. Open your arms to your brothers. You like that picture? Everybody's been getting a warm fuzzy from that picture. Yeah, there you go. In verse 1 of chapter 14, Paul says, as for the one who is weak in faith, welcome him, but not to quarrel over opinions. So first of all, the Holy Spirit wants us to avoid being argumentative. I think you would agree with me that although the internet has improved our lives, it can also bring out the worst in some people, especially people who like a good argument. I love this classic internet joke, if you can't read it, this joke that's up on the screen. If you can't read that, it says, please cancel all my meetings. Somebody on the internet is wrong. Maybe you've seen the other version of this, where there's a man hunched over his computer late at night, and his wife is looking over his shoulder, and he says, I can't come to bed yet, honey. Somebody on the internet is wrong. How many of you know we live in a contentious age? And more people seem to love a good argument. We love correcting each other. Paul's telling us here, if I could use the modern expression, don't be that guy. When someone's faith is weaker than yours, when someone is less learned than you are, be welcoming. It seems there were believers in Rome who had no problem welcoming those with different opinions, but listen, they only welcomed them so that they could straighten them out. How many of you have had this experience? You know there are few things that are more uncomfortable than meeting up with that Christian friend or that Christian relative who takes every opportunity he can to fix your beliefs. You know the type. He's kind enough to invite you over for dinner, but as soon as the dishes are cleared away, you know he's going to jump on you like a mountain lion. Say, Nick, have you had a chance to look at that article I sent you the other day? Right? Or did you think any more about that thing we were talking about the other day? See, the Roman church had some of these pouncing pumas that were waiting to jump on people. And so Paul tells them, be welcoming. Receive your fellow saints with genuine love and concern, not just so you can win them over to your ideas. Paul uses an interesting Greek word for welcome. It carries the idea of, listen, taking someone to yourself. What a wonderful picture that is. So Paul's saying, welcome your brothers. Take them to yourself. Receive them into your hearts. Show them some true hospitality, the kind of hospitality that simply wants to refresh people. And there's no agendas or hidden motives. Who knows? You might end up enjoying their company so much that you'll forget that you have better doctrine than they do. Church, once we decide to drop our swords, then we are free to open our arms to our brothers instead. Four keys to developing a welcoming spirit. Number one, open your arms to your brothers. The second one is this: don't despise or judge your brothers. Don't despise or judge your brothers. In verse 3, Paul condemns two troublesome attitudes. Now, these attitudes are not unique to the Roman church. In fact, I think you'd agree with me that they are baked in to human psychology. Paul says, let not the one who eats despise, everybody say that word, despise the one who abstains, and let not the one who abstains pass judgment. Everybody say that, judgment, on the one who eats. Why? For God has welcomed him. Paul recognizes that the strong Christian who feels that he can eat will have a tendency to look down on the weak Christian. He will think that that weak Christian is too legalistic, too religious. The strong believer will tend to think contemptuously of people who are not as free or not as advanced as he thinks he is. On the other hand, Paul says that the weak Christian, the one whose conscience will not let him eat certain things, that weak Christian might be judgmental of those who don't feel the way that he does. And so the weak believer will think that the strong believer is sinning, that he's living an ungodly life because of what he's doing. Now listen, before we go further into this, I want to be clear about something. And church, we need the Lord's help. We need grace from God to get this today. What Paul is talking about here are matters of conscience. So Paul says we mustn't judge people about matters of conscience. In other words, these are not things that affect our salvation. These are things that the word doesn't call sinful in and of themselves. The reason we can't judge people in matters of conscience is that we can't judge their motives. And if we can't know their motives, then we need to leave judgment to the one who does. And that is God, of course. We need God's wisdom on this matter, because how many of you know that we live in a day when the only Bible verse that anybody seems to remember is the one that says, judge not, lest you be judged. And yet, when we read the New Testament, it is clear that God does not want us to forego judging completely. How do we know this? We know this because we are actually sometimes told to judge. See, there are things that are clearly wrong in the scriptures. And the scripture never gives us permission to do what God forbids. When people are committing open and obvious sin, it is an abuse of God's word to say, well, we can't judge. St. Augustine explained this beautifully. Listen to what Augustine said about Romans 14. He said, when something might be done with either good or bad motives, we should leave the judgment to God and not presume to judge the heart of someone else, which we do not see. But when it comes to things which obviously could not have been done with good and innocent intentions, it is not wrong if we pass judgment. So, in the matter of food, where it is not known what the motive in eating it is, Paul does not want us to be judges, but God. But in the case of that abominable immorality where a man took his stepmother, Paul taught us to judge. Now, if you don't know what he's talking about, there was a man you can read about back in 1 Corinthians 5 who committed adultery with his stepmother. And all God's people said, gross, right? So Augustine continues, says, that man who did that could not possibly claim that he committed such a gross act of indecency with good intentions. So we must pass judgment on things which are obviously wrong. That's what St. Augustine said. Pastor Glenn said it like this. We shouldn't treat gray areas as absolutes, nor should we treat absolutes like gray areas. And the latter is our problem today. Now, I hope this thinks all of us to think biblically the next time that somebody tells you that their actions cannot be judged. Because, church, listen, it's always true that only God can see our hearts. But it is often the case that our actions reveal what is in our hearts. The modern Christian is very quick to say, well, God knows my heart. But the Bible's response to that is, yes, he does know your heart. That's why he said to repent. If you can't say amen, say ouch. So let's realize that what Paul is driving at here is not, he's not talking about matters of sin. He's talking about matters of conscience. We should also notice in our reading today, listen, this is important. Paul was giving people freedom to live like a Gentile or to live like a Jew, if they so desired. But nowhere in Paul's writings would he ever let people compel you to live under the law in order to be accepted by God. Do you get it? As we've seen before, Paul is always careful to say that no law can save us. We can only be saved by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. But listen, while the Romans might not have been perverting the gospel like some other churches did, this is not a problem like the church in Galatia had. The Romans here were still making a serious mistake. They were judging each other unrighteously. Now, why was it wrong for them to judge each other? Paul explains, and this will be very helpful to all of us as well. Paul says it was wrong for them to judge first because God had already accepted them. Paul says in verse 3, not to despise or judge your brother because God has welcomed him. God says that brother does have faith, even if it's weak faith. And God already welcomed that man when he trusted in Jesus. You know, the simplest saint, the newest Christian, the least learned that you know should never be despised, because God has already accepted her or him. Second, we shouldn't judge our brothers, Paul says, because they are God's servants, not ours. Paul says in verse 4, who are you to pass judgment on the servant of another? It's before his own master that he stands or falls, and he will be upheld because the Lord is able to make him stand. Now, you know, Paul's usually quite gentle with the church here, but read between the lines, this is a powerful rebuke. Paul is saying, you are not in charge of that other person's faith. They don't answer to you. They are answerable to God, and he is well able to straighten them out. Church, we must learn that God can straighten people out if they need it. Listen, love them first, and maybe they will feel safe enough with you to ask for a little help. And as somebody likes to say, that's good preaching. Why not judge each other? A third reason not to judge is because we, all of us, weak or strong, we are all seeking God's approval. Paul says in verse 6, the one who eats, eats in honor of the Lord, since he gives thanks to God, while the one who abstains, abstains in honor of the Lord and gives thanks to God. This is one reason why God accepts our actions, even if we're weak, because both the weak and the strong have the same goal, Paul says, and that goal is to please God. One abstains and another eats, but all of us believe that we are honoring God by our actions. And God sees this, and he honors that. So listen, I may not agree with my brother, but love compels me to recognize that he is trying to bring pleasure to God's heart the best way he knows how. And if I catch myself starting to think otherwise, that should be a sign to me that I'm getting off track. And that's why Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 13, the famous love chapter, that love believes all things. Love believes the best about a person's motives until proven otherwise. Another reason not to judge is that for both sides, judgment will be here soon enough. In verse 10, Paul reminds us, why do you pass judgment on your brother? Or you, why do you despise your brother? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God. Therefore, let's not pass judgment on one another any longer. This is a not so subtle reminder from the Holy Spirit to us that if it's judgment you want, don't worry. That friend with whom you disagree will soon appear before the supreme judge, and so will you. Those in authority over us may have no choice but to bring correction where there is actual sin or scandal. But hear me, church, in doubtful matters, in matters of conscience, in matters about which people may disagree without touching the main issues of our faith, let us beware and let us be careful not to take the place of God, the judge. Final reason why we shouldn't judge our brothers and sisters is this: unrighteous judging means that we have surrendered to a fault-finding spirit. Paul says, God has already welcomed that brother with whom I disagree. So if I refuse to welcome him, I've become his accuser instead. I am no longer walking like Christ if I refuse to welcome the one that God has welcomed. And if I judge him unrighteously, then I am actually displaying the attitude of the enemy instead. Scripture calls the devil the accuser of the brethren, and for good reason. Why would we want to join with the devil in all of his nitpicking of your fellow believers? Many of you know that the devil's fault-finding spirit poisons the very atmosphere anywhere it goes. So let's refuse to participate in ungodly fault-finding, and that's good preaching also. We're talking about four keys to getting along in the family of God and developing a welcoming spirit. First, open your arms to your brothers. Second, don't despise or judge them. The third one is this: imitate Jesus. Put your brother first. Imitate Jesus and put your brother first. You know, Paul wasn't done stretching us even when he told us not to judge. He goes beyond that, and he even tells us to give up our rights and our right to please ourselves so that our brothers and sisters can grow up in their own faith. He warns us about stumbling blocks and obstacles. In verse 13, Paul says, therefore, let us not pass judgment on one another any longer, but rather decide. Decide never to put a stumbling block or a hindrance in the way of a brother. Now, Paul's making a pun here in Greek that gets lost in the translation. The word for decide is actually the same word for passing judgment. So in the original, Paul was actually saying, don't judge each other, but instead judge this. Judge that you shouldn't hinder your brother. Don't decide you're right. Decide not to hinder his faith. What are these stumbling blocks and hindrances? Paul used a couple of different words here. Stumbling blocks are small things that we carelessly leave behind for people to trip over. Might not have been done on purpose, but yet somebody could still trip over it. A hindrance or an obstacle, on the other hand, is something larger that's been put in my way to block me. It's placed in my path deliberately. Paul is saying that our weaker brothers are learning to follow God in their own paths. So let's make sure that we don't accidentally become a stumbling block to them. And of course, let's not deliberately hinder them. Let's not make their journey or their growth harder than it needs to be. In verse 15, he says, by what you eat, don't destroy the one for whom Christ died. Paul means, and this is challenging, church, for us, that we should avoid exercising our rights when this might cause our brothers to be grieved. You may have a right in the Lord to do what you're doing, but why insist on provoking someone else by what you allow yourself to do? If you did so, Paul says, you would no longer be walking in love toward your brother. This is not just about food, but this could be about many things. As Paul says, it is not good to do anything that causes your brother to stumble. You know, rather than picking a fight with your brother, Paul says, rather than judging him, why not decide instead not to provoke him or injure him? Allow that person to grow until she understands that she also has freedom in Christ. That's far more loving and far more Christ-like than causing someone to sin. You know, church, I will freely admit to you that there are a couple of verses here which are difficult to understand. But remember, Pastor Glenn said he gives me all the hard ones. So Paul says in verse 23, whoever has doubts is condemned if he eats because the eating is not from faith. For whatever does not proceed from faith, whatever doesn't come from faith is sin. And many people have wondered what these words mean. This is important for us to understand how your conscience works. So put your thinking caps on. Paul is saying here that if you compel someone to act against his conscience, he is no longer acting with faith in God. And so you're causing him to sin. You might ask, well, Pastor Nick, how could I be causing him to sin by making him do something that God says is all right to do? The answer is this. If someone decides to do something that his conscience is telling him is displeasing to God, that means he has decided to do something wrong. Now, what he's doing may not actually be wrong in the sense that God forbids it, but you have convinced him to do what he believes is wrong, listen, and not to care what God thinks about it. That means he's no longer interested in pleasing God in that matter. He's more interested in pleasing you. So at that point, if that happens, he is deliberately doing something that he thinks God views as a sin. And that would be a sinful attitude. Why? Because inside his heart, when someone violates his own conscience, what is he saying? He is saying, God says this is wrong, or I think God feels this is wrong, but I don't care. I'm going to do it anyway. See, so that's why Paul tells us that whatever doesn't come from faith, whether it's eating something you're not sure you should eat and all of that type of thing, whatever doesn't come from faith is sin. So Paul wants us to know that one way that we love people is by not pushing them, by not forcing them to violate their conscience about what God allows them to do. And as far as our own hearts are concerned, our responsibility is to do our best to make sure that everything we do is pleasing to God and that we are convinced of that for ourselves so that we will have a clean conscience about those things as well. Do you have a strong faith? Paul says, good for you. The Holy Spirit tells us in chapter 15, verse 1, we who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Let each one of us please his neighbor for good to build him up. For Christ did not please himself. So instead of insisting that we're right or insisting on our rights, let's imitate Christ who put us first. Let's not put a stumbling block before him. And if we live that way, Paul says, we will be accepted by God and people will approve of us as well. Boil it down to this. Let's give no offense. Let's take no offense. Now you know why that even the Apostle Peter said there's some things in Paul's letters that are hard to understand. Amen. How do we avoid family fights in God's house? How do we develop a welcoming spirit? Open your arms to your brothers. Don't judge your brother. Put your brother first. And finally this, let's focus together on the kingdom essentials. How do you develop a welcoming spirit? Focus together on the kingdom essentials. Worship team, you can come back, please, and help us. In Romans 14, 17, Paul gives us a very famous verse. He says, the kingdom of God is not about food and drink, but what? Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So here's another way to avoid judging our brothers, another way to welcome them. We need to focus, church, listen, we need to focus on what the kingdom is really about. It's not about religious practices or other secondary matters. None of these things are the main issues of life or of the gospel. How many of you know that our life in the Spirit does not come from regulations? It's not contained in perfect doctrine. But we experience life in the Spirit as He ministers to us righteousness, peace, and joy. The great old Bible commentator Matthew Henry said it like this: it will not be asked at the great day, who ate meat and who ate vegetables? Who kept holy days and who did not? Nor will it be asked who was of this or that denomination. But it will be asked who feared God and worked righteousness and who did not. In verse 17, Paul brilliantly boils down the essentials of the kingdom into these three words, and it's these we need to focus on and encourage others to do the same. Those three things must be the main concerns of my heart. Righteousness. Righteousness is the thing I should be concerned about in my relationship with God. Have I truly been born again by the Spirit? Have I received the gift of righteousness through Christ the Son? Or am I still seeking to earn a place in His heaven? Can I say that I possess that righteousness and that I'm seeking to live righteously? Peace. Peace is what I should be concerned about in my relationship with my fellow believers. Am I walking in love toward them? Am I walking in patience and forgiveness toward them? Am I a peacemaker in the body of Christ, or am I a peace breaker? This is the counsel of Scripture. The Holy Spirit says to us, pursue peace with all men, and as much as it depends on you, be at peace with them. And church, then there's joy. That joy is the thing that I need to be concerned about as I look into my own heart. I should always find it there. It's the essential characteristic of the Christian heart. Joy is the first one of the fruits of the Spirit, second only to love. Paul says it's a supernatural thing. It's joy in the Holy Ghost. It's something supernatural that we experience because we've been joined to Jesus Christ. It's the never-ending delight that I feel in knowing that I'm my beloved's and He is mine. That joy of the Lord is my source of strength. The joy that comes to me in a steady stream from the rivers of His presence inside of my own spirit. And church, let me tell you, if I can't sense that joy, then I need to quickly step aside and examine myself, check my own heart, and see what there might be in there that is blocking that stream of joy that Jesus is always wanting to release from within me. And may He assist us so that we can help our brothers and sisters experiencing it too. Focusing together on those great kingdom essentials will help all of us to rise above what is small, what is petty, and it will help us to get along together. It will help me to develop a welcoming spirit. It's going to make you magnetically attractive, just like Jesus. It'll make you an encourager instead of a discourager if you'll focus your heart on righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So let's open our arms to our brothers. Let's not judge them anymore. Let's decide to put our brothers first, and let's focus together on those kingdom essentials. Hear those concluding words from the Holy Spirit as we close. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, Paul says, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. Amen. Come on, let's stand together. Let's give Jesus a hand of praise in his house today. Oh, come on.